welcome back to my channel, Bohemian Magic Studios. I'm Justina, and thank you guys so much for tuning in once again. We are in the Yule season, and it is so exciting because it's my birthday month, and although I'm turning another year older, it's just nice to look back and reflect on how I've grown in the past however many years, and, you know, all that good stuff. But anyway, I know in the last video you guys saw I was a little bit sick. I do have a little bit of a residual cough still trying to get rid of it. This thing just lingers, you know what I mean? But anyway, I just got back from a few days in Disney World in the Sunshine State of Florida, and it was so much fun, and I always love visiting Disney World, and I've never been there around Christmas time before. It's really weird seeing Christmas stuff all over the place when it's not very cold. It was 80 degrees and sunny the whole time we were there, and I'm not complaining. I love the warm weather, but something about it just didn't feel like Christmas to me. I couldn't really get into the spirit until we got back home and, you know, felt that cold chill in the air and wanting to make that warm cup of tea, and finally got into decorating the tree. Finally in the spirit, and I did have this little book that I got around Thanksgiving time that I'm sure you guys saw briefly in my last video about the practical magic issue. If you guys haven't seen that, definitely watch that here, or I'll link it in the description down below. I briefly teased this Yule book right here by Llewellyn Sabbat Essentials, and I'm obsessed with this series, you guys. I know there's some debate on whether or not using these little beginner books, or some people in the witchy community have put these books on blast, but honestly, I'm not gonna hate on these books. I think they're really informative, and they have a lot of other things in here besides just spells and stuff. I know there was some debate on whether or not these books are good for giving you spell ideas and stuff, because the whole thing is, the more you put your own energy into your own spell work, better results you're gonna get, and I completely understand that. I don't think these books are too based on spell work. They're more based on the Wheel of the Year and the history behind it, no matter what culture you're from. It's kind of like a broad spectrum of different things from different cultures, and I think it's really interesting, so I think it's definitely worth the read if you're into learning more about the history behind the Wheel of the Year. The Wheel of the Year, I thought, was more ancient, but apparently it was made more popular by Gerald Gardner, who invented Wicca. The interesting thing about the Wheel of the Year is that there are so many different aspects taken from so many different cultures throughout history. It is Yule right now for us in the Northern Hemisphere, and it is actually Litha, which is midsummer solstice for those of you folk in the Southern Hemisphere. So happy Litha to you guys down there, and Merry Yule to you guys up here in the Northern Hemisphere where I am located. So I just wanted to flip through this book today. This kind of comes full circle. The last book review I did on the Sabbat Essentials was for Litha this past midsummer solstice. I did the review on that, so you can go watch that up here. All of these Llewellyn Sabbat books are kind of set up the same. First you have the intro, which gives you the basis of the Wheel of the Year. They give you one section of the Northern Hemisphere, and then they give you the wheel for the Southern Hemisphere, so it is really cool that you have both to revert to when you need point of reference. Then it kind of just gives you a little brief thing about the traditions in Wiccan lore. This is a time when the young solar god is born. In Neo-Pagan traditions, this is where the Holly King is destined to lose the battle to his lighter aspect, which is the Oak King, which is the king that we celebrate in Litha. So when Litha comes around, that is when the Oak King loses his battle, because then it starts to descend into the darker period of the year. Those are the two main gods that Litha and Yule are kind of revolving around. But there are so many other gods and goddesses in this book that you can pay tribute to around this time of season, and it's not just one god or goddess that you have to acknowledge. That's the cool thing about the pagan traditions, is that there's so many different gods and goddesses in different traditions that you can kind of use, and just use whatever parts of it that kind of resonate with you. Some people who follow the Wheel of the Year that don't follow the whole Wheel of the Year. Some people follow the cross fire Sabbats. Lunasa, Beltane, Imbolc, and Samhain are the fire Sabbats, which some people just follow those. So, I mean, it really all depends on your own traditions, your own beliefs, whatever you decide to follow. So, on to the next portion of the book. This section gets into the old ways, and they kind of just have imagery pertaining to the season. They have a stag, and they have some holly and pine cones and bells. This section basically goes into the old traditions and how our ancestors used to celebrate. So this is basically going into the history of the calendar and how our new calendar came into effect. They go into the meaning behind the month of December. December means 10 because that was the 10th month in the original Roman calendar, and eventually the Romans added January, February to the calendar, thus making December the 12th month, but they left it with its original name to avoid confusion. So it's really interesting how the months changed throughout history and how things evolved into what they are known as today. Then you have the astronomical cycle of Yule, which is, it tells you how midwinter is linked to astronomy. Astronomically, the winter solstice is the longest night of the year. It usually falls on December 21st to December 22nd. December 20th is my birthday, so I'm like right before the solstice. The solstice is the longest night of the year. It is part of the astronomical cycle that recurs each year with only slight variation. In the Northern Hemisphere, the winter solstice marks the beginning of winter, the shortest day and the longest night of the year, and the farther north one moves, the more profoundly affects. And those living on the 45th parallel, halfway between the equator and the North Pole, will experience about 8.5 hours of light and 15.5 hours of darkness at the solstice. If you go farther north to Anchorage, Alaska, and the winter solstice sun rises at about 10 a.m. and goes down by 3 p.m. after only clearing a few degrees above the horizon. For people in the Arctic Circle, the winter solstice means near complete darkness, and at the North Pole, the sun doesn't rise at all. Let me just tell you, the lack of sun really does affect you. You need the vitamins from the sun to kind of like boost your mood and elevate, you know, your production levels. And I was just watching a vlog where somebody went to Alaska for a few days and they were saying how the lack of sun there was really affecting their mood even for like the few days that they were there. I think the sun definitely does have an effect on us and all of the energy we put into our magic. So this basically just goes into the mythological cycles of Yule, the goddesses, queens, mothers, heroines that are associated with the holiday. And along with the goddesses, you have the gods, kings, fathers, and heroes. There's a lot of information here, so I'm not gonna read everything because I don't want to spoil the book for you guys as well, but I'm just gonna go into the bullet points and kind of like the headings of each section of the book so you can see what kinds of things are in here, and if they interest you, you could pick up a copy yourself. I will link this in the description down below as well. There's a section called Yule's Fools and Misrules. This section was really interesting to me, and this is pertaining to organized religion, and the church has this idea of proper decorum back in the old days, and I mean they still do today, but back then there were uproar events that popped up around the solstice, which were called the Feasts of Fools, where people not under organized religion, they would hold these feasts and they would mock organized religion. So they were attempts by the people to escape the iron fisted rule of the church. In England, a Lord of Misrule was eventually appointed from the local lords and nobles and entrusted with watching over the festivities to make sure they didn't get too out of hand. So I thought that was really funny. There's a holiday or a festival called Saturnalia, which would fit into the Misrules category. They were also saying that around this time, slaves and their masters would switch places. This was to ensure crops would grow again when the sun and warmth arrived. These actual festivities were very loud and very rambunctious and very full of mockery toward organized religion. There's also something called Morris dancers or mummers, where different cultures act out the season of midwinter using drama and dance to form regional customs and traditions. So they have mummer plays that are still performed throughout Britain today, and they reenact a ritual slaying of the dark winter and the rebirth of the coming of the light. Then there's just like different traditions that this goes into, like gift giving, history of the Yule log. In olden times, the Yule log was traditionally made of oak, and it was used in a ceremony that cleansed and blessed the home. They would find the largest possible log and trim it to fit the fireplace. They would decorate it with carvings that resembled the shape of the Celtic mother crone. As the embodiment of cold and death, she was tossed into the fire so that the family could watch as winter was replaced by heat and light. So this ritual is in keeping with the burning log's representation of the waxing solar year. The log was anointed with ale, mead, whiskey, and lit on Solstice Eve, ideally on the first try, and they would use a piece of the previous year's log as kindling, which is tradition. Once it's lit, you have to watch it through the night, make wishes, and toast over the log, and you're supposed to tell stories in its presence. If the Yule log burns out in the morning, it was considered a most positive omen. You can also anoint your Yule log with pine, cedar, juniper, or other evergreen oils, and you're supposed to concentrate on a good Yule and give thanks for the ways the evergreens endure and the way that the wood helps protect us from the cold. So you can write prayers and petitions and tie it to the Yule log with colored ribbons or string that correspond with the holiday, like greens, reds, gold, and work with correspondences such as endurance, strength, triumph, protection, and luck. You're supposed to light your Yule log ideally in a dark room and light it with a no-match technique such as the flint or concealed fire starters impregnated with beeswax and essential oils. That's pretty interesting. Contemplate the miracle of fire, warmth, and light. Imagine your prayers and wishes being sent to the guardians and shining ones in the smoke. You may wish to engage in a little fire scrying as you stare into the flames. If your ceremony involves others, be sure to offer cheers and toasts and tell good stories. So now it goes into the Gregorian calendar in the new year, the Julian calendar, tells you what the ancient Egyptians did, Scottish tradition. Then it gets into the new ways. There are so many different ways we can celebrate today. You can wear sweaters like I am right now. You can make a pot of soup, baked apples, curl up with a good book or cup of tea, which is my favorite pastime. During this month, many folks make the seasonal changes in their homes that tell them winter is arriving. Flannel sheets on the beds, winter colored towels in the bathroom, new altar arrangement, which I have to get to doing today. And I really want to do a day in the life video or vlog about me finding my Yule log this year, because I really want to place a little Yule log on my seasonal altar upstairs. Now, here it tells you kind of the different traditions in different cultures, which is really interesting. So they go into the Japan solstice period, known as Toji, the Mexican tradition between December 16th and 24th, known as Las Posadas. That's the midwinter celebration held throughout Mexico. The Iranians celebrate the longest night of the year, called Yalda. In China, under the old monarchies, December 22nd was the day in which the emperor led an annual round of sacrifices to the gods. These rituals were secret, so I don't know if they really have any specific kind of name. It doesn't say a specific name in the book. So it basically tells you all the different kinds of festivals from different cultures, which is really interesting. So for Wiccans, the holiday is known as Yule and takes place on Solstice Eve and the day itself. A Wiccan Yule ritual typically involves casting a circle, calling the quarters, directions, watchtowers, raising energy, doing focused work with the deity. A Yule log is often the central focus. This usually entails workings for peace, goodwill, and a prosperous new year. Now here it gives you some different ideas that you can do to celebrate Yule. I decorate with greenery, including the Yule tree, which I have right here. Dream divination. Dreams experienced during the 12 days are felt to be prophetic of the coming year. Dreams are tracked by journaling, so you can do a dream journal for Yule and see what kind of dreams you can remember and see if you can kind of decipher any of those meanings. Maybe it'll shed some light on what's to come for your new year. Hoodening, which is dressing in animal skins and masks, acting out plays, dancing, processions, parading with animal effigies, skulls, etc. Mummering, Morris dancing, and sword dancing. These are all choreographed dances with swords, lots of leaping and clashing. Concludes with mock beheading followed by ceremonial resurrection. Sounds really dramatic, and I think they still do that in Europe. Wassailing, which is carrying wassail from house to house, using it to bless fruit trees, ensuring a bountiful harvest in the coming year. Wassail is a mixture of blends and spices. We actually got some wassail when we went to the Biltmore Estate in North Carolina a year ago. We still have it around here somewhere. It's so good. You just add a little bit of it to some wine. You could even add some to some tea or hot water, and it's just like really warm and spicy, and it's such a cozy drink, and wassail is awesome. You should try it wassail if you haven't. You could even make your own wassail. So then it tells you about the natural world at Yule time, about, you know, how nature is, it slows down, the animals start hibernating, and depending on where you live, you could see the northern lights, which is really cool, which is on my bucket list. I don't know about you, but it should be on your bucket list if it's not, because that is like a phenomenon that, like, it doesn't even feel like it would be real. Like, it's so gorgeous if you've ever seen pictures or videos of it. Like, that's definitely something that I really want to see. Symbols of midwinter. So some of the symbols are birth and renewal, candles, remind us of the return of the light, colors, red and greens. Evergreens are a symbol because they remain green and vital all year, and they are a symbol of life, strength, perseverance, and protection during the harshness of winters. So that's kind of why people started decorating with evergreens. If you use artificial greens, which this is a fake tree behind me, you're still capturing the evergreen essence. You can dress your artificial greens with a few drops of essential conifer oil. So if you have like a little spray bottle and some essential oil, you could put a little bit in some water and spray it on your tree. And you can also use a diffuser. If you have a diffuser, just keep your diffuser going, and you could just keep your room smelling really nice and Yule-like. Feasting is a big thing because in the ancient times, winter was a terrifying time for a lot of people. Not everybody had food all winter long. Then it goes into gift giving and how it's a focal symbol of many winter traditions. It is about your willingness to share your own good fortune with others. These kinds of communal actions provide a deep meaning to our experience of the solstice season and bring us together as one. So that's really nice. Guising, the act of disguising one as an animal. The Aborigines used to honor symbolic or totem animals and enact the idea of sacrifice by becoming symbolically related to the animals that sustain them through the winter. Herbs and spices, some of the main herbs that are associated with Yule: cedar, fir, cinnamon, cardamom, peppermint. They're all those really warm and spicy herbs. You can dress your candles with them, you can infuse them into tea, in your coffee, hot chocolate. You could put them out in your bowls of potpourri. Simmer herbs and slice citrus in a kettle of water on a stovetop. Drip essential oils into your bath water. These are all great ideas to get your house smelling really warm and spicy for the season, and I would love to try some of these ideas, especially the potpourri on the kettle on the stove. Magical animals have a key place in lore. Here's a cute little story about a raven and how he is the bringer of light. A long time ago, the raven looked down from the sky and saw that the people of the world were living in darkness. The ball of light was kept hidden by a selfish old chief. So the raven turned himself into a spruce needle and floated on the river where the chief's daughter came for water. She drank the spruce needle. She became pregnant and gave birth to a boy, which was the raven in disguise. The baby cried and cried until the chief gave him the ball of light to play with. As soon as he had the light, the raven turned back into himself and carried the light into the sky. From then on, we no longer live in darkness. So that's just a cute little folk tale. They go into all the animals that are associated with the season, like the male deer or stag is associated with the horned god. The deer's antlers resemble tree branches, and like the tree branches, the antlers are shed and regrown each year in a real-life example of rebirth and rejuvenation. Cows and oxen are important symbols of food and wealth for people in subarctic climates. Pigs are also stars of midwinter. They're very intelligent and were long considered powerful sacred animals. They were also believed to come from the other world by the Celts and by the Norse, and also pigs are the Norse god of sunshine. And also the horse is sacred to many cultures. Matthews describes a midwinter ritual known as hoodening, in which a man costumed as a horse goes door to door collecting money in exchange for entertainment. The hooded horse was carried by several men known as hoodeners. Coins were placed in the horse's mouth, and in return, the hooded offered blessings and wise sayings. Hence the term from the horse's mouth. So I never knew where that term came from, but there you go, that's where it came from. Then it tells you about mistletoe, and the ancient druids harvested mistletoe at Yule, believing it to be a holy plant with protective qualities, but you're not supposed to eat it because it is poisonous, so don't eat your plants. Also, third poinsettias right here. We don't have any pets, but if you do have pets, don't leave your poinsettias within range of your pets. Most of these winter plants, I guess, are kind of poisonous, so don't ingest any of them. But if you want to use them as charms, you're more than welcome to do that. It goes into the great tree debate. This goes into the whole debate on whether or not you should get a fake tree. Here are kind of the pros and cons, I guess you could say. Every acre of trees on a Christmas tree farm provides enough oxygen for 18 people. For each Christmas tree that is harvested, as in chopped down and sold to people for Christmas, 3 seedlings are planted. So I guess they do replace whatever they cut down with 3 more trees, which is good. In 1 year, an average mature evergreen tree produces enough oxygen to support a family of 4 and absorbs the carbon dioxide pumped into the air by 4 automobiles. That's a lot. Planting trees is the cheapest, most effective way of removing excess carbon dioxide from the atmosphere. Unsold trees are composited into mulch, bark dust, and compost. So it looks like they destroy the unsold trees anyway, but they are reused as compost for gardens and to grow other life. Artificial trees were once made of aluminum, but now they're mostly made of plastics and resins, and the process of creating these trees creates a large proportion of toxic byproducts in relation to the end result, especially the fiber optic ones, the ones that change colors on the tips, which we actually have one of those. But I mean, to each their own. I mean, whether you decide to cut a tree down or use a fake one that possibly has toxic chemicals, I don't know. Do your research and do what's best for you. I mean, we've had this fake one for years. This one's not a fiber optic one, but I mean, it feels plastic, so. So in this section, it kind of goes into whether or not you think you should celebrate on the actual Sabbath holiday day, or you could celebrate it on whatever day you need to according to your own personal schedule. And that's completely up to you. Some people think that they should celebrate on the days so their magical workings are at their most potent, but hey, you need to do whatever you need to do. If you can't celebrate Yule on the 21st or 22nd, celebrate it on the 20th, on my birthday, or celebrate it on the 23rd, you know, just whenever you can get to it. Sometimes things happen. The weather isn't great. Sometimes people's schedules aren't great for meeting up with a group, and things just happen, life gets in the way. Another conundrum is the merging of traditions. So this just goes into how people nowadays, they splice different traditions together to meet individual needs of themselves, family, or friends. So it does say that many pagans who observe Yule also celebrate other December holidays such as Christmas, Hanukkah, or Diwali. And that's perfectly fine. I mean, I grew up Catholic and I still celebrate Christmas and I'm acknowledging Yule. I mean, why do you need to feel like you can only tie yourself to one specific celebration or holiday? That's silly. That's just closed-minded. And I mean, if that's how you feel, that's how you feel. But I like to be open-minded about how I celebrate the holidays. Then it goes into some final reflections. What does it mean to be a winter celebrating pagan? It means honoring the powers and gifts of the season, which are unique and distinct from those expressed during other times of the year. It means looking deep to see the true beauty of the season. Because I'm not a winter person, honestly, you guys, but if there can be some way to make me more accepting of the changing of the seasons, then I mean, this is it. It's healthy for our bodies to ebb and flow with the changing of the seasons. And I know once summer's over, we all fret and we're all bummed and it's not warm anymore. As much as I hate the winter and I hate the cold, I would feel off without it. Like I was saying, I just came back from Florida and I was down there for 4 days, and we were down there from the 1st to the 4th, and everything was decorated for Christmas down there. It was beautiful, but I didn't feel the season, you know? I'm from New Jersey, so we experience all the season changes here. Granted, it might be a little wonky from time to time, but we get the full spectrum of winter, spring, summer, fall. And I think that's why I didn't do so well when I was out in California for a little bit, because I crave that seasonal change. Like, I'm such a seasonal person. That is why I think I identify with the wheel of the year so well, because those seasonal changes are, like, embedded within me. Now it gets to the fun stuff. The spells and divination. You can use things such as reading tarot cards or tea leaves or crystal ball reading, spirit writing. They probably have candle scrying. You know, there's different ways you can use divination. My personal favorite is tarot because it's visual and there's pictures, and I'm just a visual person. I've always been. And one thing that I want to briefly share with you guys is I just got this Wildwood tarot, which is really cool, and it's really wintry looking. But that's just the box. The box looks really wintry looking, but the thing that excited me and drew me to this deck was the fact that the cards kind of embody the energies of the Wheel of the Year. And there's even a section in the book that goes into the Wheel of the Year. So they kind of cover all the seasons. You have this really pretty summery or like spring kind of scene right here. Then you have kind of like the fall raveny scene like right here. Then they have this really hot summery scene right here. And then the stuff that I was most excited about right now was wintry cards like the stag, which I thought was really beautiful. In the book, they do have a section on how the cards kind of go around the Wheel of the Year. So I thought that was really cool, especially since I am all about studying the Wheel of the Year. I'm not gonna go too much into this book in this video. Maybe I'll do another video on it because I just got this deck and I kind of want to dive into it, and I kind of want to do some winter readings with it because that's what I bought it for. I bought it for my winter readings because it's got some beautiful backing. It's green and I think it will go lovely on my... I have a red cloth over here, so I thought that would look really pretty. But anyways, back to this book. Our spells and divinations chapter goes into magical timing and when you think you should perform your magic. It says here that during the morning hours, the sun takes charge of the world and we experience a waxing energy. And then the midday, it's kind of like a balance. You have equal day, equal night. During the afternoon, the sun's energy begins to wane. And then at sunset, that's called twilight. This is liminal time, standing between day and night. It's deeply magical, making it a good time to work with charms and spells to appeal or to petition to deities. And I also think twilight's the best time to work with fairy magic, honestly, because that's when the fairies come out. So night is an ideal time to address fears, challenges, and obstacles. Midnight is also known as the witching hour and the high time for magic of all sorts. And exactly what I said before, the same goes for late night, which is like a happy hour for sprites, fairies, and spirit visitations. Also consider the idea of the eve, which refers to the night before an important event, such as like Christmas Eve, or Yule Eve, is an incredibly powerful time magically. It implies not only a balance between what has happened and what is about to come, but also creates a tension between past, present, and future. It's a time of both transition and threshold, a potent time for magical or spiritual work, especially reflective work and divination. Then it goes into winter spellcrafts, what you can do, correspondences, what kind of music you could do, chanting, singing, sound of drums, bells, and then it goes into prepping any magical workings and some questions that you should ask yourself. It gives you a little bit of a house cleansing and blessing ritual you can do right here. Feel free to add your own words if you want to. Nothing in here is written in stone. It gives you a little protection, Lorica for Yule, which is like a breastplate, and it tells you how you can make your own breastplate, magical bags for multiple purposes, like little gree-gree bags or like little charm bags you can use. Tells you how to make a Yuletide dream pillow. For sleep, you can use lavender and cedar. For inspired dreams, you can use mugwort, rosemary, and clove. And psychic inspiration and astral travel, you can use cinnamon and cardamom. And to make sure Santa will come, try a cookie theme. Cinnamon, vanilla, and a dash of sprinkles. So it's fun little stuff in here. Here's a cute little gingerbread man poppet to safeguard your gifts. And there's a cute little illustration, and it tells you the stuff that you need to make it and the stuff that you can put inside. You can make a Yule log talisman. You can sew the ashes of your Yule log into a small magical bag or pop it. You can also put it on your altar or by the door. And then you can do some spells to bring snow. Now, I never wanted to bring snow. I am not a snow person, especially when you have to drive in it. Although I do think it's pretty to watch from time to time, but once it starts like turning into ice and slush, it's just no fun. But when you're a kid and you don't have to go to school the next day because it snows, of course you want it to snow. So here's some things that you can do so you can make it snow and get a snow day out of it. Wear your pajamas backwards, brush your teeth with your opposite hand, flush at least 6 ice cubes down the toilet, and sleep with a silver spoon under your pillow. Supposedly, wearing pajamas backwards confuses the snow gods, and it says bonus points if the pajamas have feet. So I thought that was really cute. And the ice cubes is supposed to help create a cold front. And the silver spoon tradition has an unknown origin, but dates back hundreds of years. Some extra things you could do is toss ice cubes into a tree, stack pennies on your windowsill. Each inch of pennies is supposed to equal an inch of snowfall. Put a white crayon in your freezer and run around your table 5 times. So these things might make you look absolutely crazy, or they might actually work, but who knows until you try. So if you want to try any of these ideas to make it snow, let me know how it turns out in the comments down below. So there's an appeal for protection through winter's long nights. You light a candle and repeat the following. A talisman for protection during travel, for strength enduring family connections. There's some herbal tea magic ideas. You can do a clear seeing tea, mind magic tea, winter relaxer tea, and a tummy settling tea. And they give you all the ingredients for all these teas right there. There's a generosity charm. Take a piece of ribbon from a favorite gift you've received and put it on your altar. And then it goes into a little bit about magical winter waters and the magical properties that you can charge your winter water with. Some of the following ideas are for making your own magical water. So you can expose your water to winter solstice sunrise or moonrise or any other winter occasions that are important to you. You can charge your water under an eclipse. Collect dew on the solstice or during the winter. If it happens to rain or snow during winter solstice, collect rainwater or snow for later use. You can break icicles, melt them at room temperature, and then use them, save it for your spell work. Those are just some examples of what to do with some of that winter water. You can use your winter water for any of the following purposes. You can anoint your magical tools, charms, poppets, other items. You can use it to dress your candles or other altar items, sprinkle water on plants or trees that need a magical boost. You can use it as an offering to the winter sprites and fairies. It doesn't say that in here, but I think that would be a good idea. You can use it to charge your waters and to brew teas. That's my personal favorite because I have some tea right here. Or you could save containers of snow or whole icicles in your freezer and use when spring arrives in a ritual designed to bid farewell to winter. I think around like February, March, I'm like, okay, winter needs to end already. So in the Old Ways chapter, they explore the idea of sacred mothers of winter, which you can also think about honoring your own divine mother. You could set up your own altar space and dedicate it to whatever winter goddess that you decide to work with. Make a Porter Pagan magic set, which I think this is really cute. You could take like an old little Altoid container or like any kind of like old mint container, glue on fabric, decorate it however you want, and then place in tiny birthday cake candles and little beads. You could stick them in there, they act as candle holders. Small altar cloth, package of salt, a few gems or crystals. Quartz is best used for general purposes, or you can try anything else. Turquoise is the birthstone for December, so you could use that. Put in a small vial of essential oils, incense cone, mirror for scrying, or anything else that suits your purpose, and you could tuck it into a little bag, tie it shut with a cord, and leave in your purse, briefcase, glove box, wherever you need to store it. It's just a really good idea to have a little kit ready for on the go. Then it goes into divination and augury. Whether we divine or augur, the process brings together magic, intention, intuition, and messages from the natural and magical worlds to help us understand what's happening around us, what's happened in our past, and what's waiting around the next bend. So divination is kind of a tool to understand the meaning of the deeper world around you. Kind of get answers from an otherworldly realm that we can't see on our physical human plane. Next, we get to my personal favorite part. There's a couple tarot spreads in here. We have the Midwinter Solstice spread, which is a 7-card tree spread. Then we have the regular solstice spread, which is a 4-card spread. Then it tells you a little bit about divination using animal tracks, omens, scrying in frozen puddles or frost panes, winter augury, which is like kind of trying to see images and meanings in objects. You can do this with reading clouds, responding to patterns shown in fallen branches. You can observe patterns in flocks of birds or intuiting meanings in snowbanks. Good augury means using your imagination, staying alert, and finding time to be outdoors. So this is basically just being aware of your surroundings and kind of just like trying to read into the signs you see in nature. So that's kind of a fun practice to get into, especially if you like taking long walks in the woods in the wintertime. I don't do too much of that because I personally do not like the cold, even though I am a winter baby. Sometimes if I'm bundled up enough, like a nice walk in the snow is really nice. It says the Yule tree must be taken down by Twelfth Night, or there will be bad luck. Put holly and ivy leaves under a pillow on New Year's Eve to dream of one's future husband. If one opens all doors on midnight on Yule, evil and unkind spirits will depart. So it's just like little folk tales. Tassiomancy is like reading tea leaves, so it tells you how to read tea leaves here, which is fun. And then this section is about recipes and crafts, and I'm really excited to try some of the recipes and crafts in here. There's a wonderful recipe in here for sugar cookies. Then we have a ridiculously rich eggnog recipe. I've never had homemade eggnog though. I've always had it out of the carton that you buy at the store, but I'm really excited to try the homemade eggnog recipe. Here we come a wassailing. So the word wassail means good health and offered as a toast with goblets raised, and you can drink it in wine. It's a traditional hot English beverage made by combining alcohol, particularly applejack or apple brandy, fruit juices, and lots of winter spices. A good wassail usually includes the following: allspice, nutmeg, cinnamon, and clove. Whole small apples or oranges and kumquats are often roasted and added to the mixture. It's usually served from a large silver bowl and ladled into silver or pewter goblets with bright ribbons tied around their bases. Wow, that's pretty precise. In folk terms, wassail is also used as an apple tree spirit offering to bless orchards, drive away evil spirits, and increase their yields. There's a nice recipe for wassail here. As I said before, I did buy a package of pre-made wassail from the Biltmore Estate in North Carolina, which is a gorgeous day trip. If you ever get the chance and you're in Asheville, North Carolina, go see Biltmore Estate. But they had wassail there and I bought it, and because they had little sampler cups there and we tried it there and I was like, oh my god, this is so good. I have to have this, to take this home with me. But I am interested to make my own special blend. There's a recipe for rumple mince pie. There's tree decorating chili, which is a perfect meal to serve for tree decorating night. We already decorated our tree, but I mean, you could just have a night of friends and games and make some Yule chili. I mean, you can name it whatever you want. It still sounds delicious. And if you're not a meat eater, you could just make vegan chili. Then there's foil dinners, which you could cook in the fireplace. I unfortunately don't have a real fireplace. We have a fake fireplace, but if you do have a fireplace, you can do foil dinners in your fire. And basically it's just like a bunch of vegetables and meats placed in a tin foil and you just cook it in the fire. Grown-up treat Yule teeny. So here's a little cordial that you can make, which is sounds lovely. It's just like a mason jar. I guess it's kind of like the solstice wine that I made for Litha, which you could see in my Litha vlog over here somewhere. I did make some solstice wine for that. Then there are some recipes for gifting and sharing. So this is just like a bundle of herbs that you can give away as gifts. A hot chocolate kit. So these are just like cute little gift ideas and really inexpensive ways to, you know, if you don't have the money to go all out and buy people materialistic things, you can gift them with spices and hot chocolate kits. Even bath salts, which is what that's in here, but that's one of my personal favorite things to gift to people. It's really inexpensive to make. All you need is some salt, which is really inexpensive. You get at the grocery store, and also add your favorite drops of essential oils and some of your favorite herbs. And I think it's just like a really pretty gift that somebody can use for their own personal wellness and to help them feel good about themselves and relax. So I personally love the idea of giving bath salts and homemade bath and body products as Christmas gifts. And you can store them in cute little mason jars, put some ribbon around it, tie little charms to it, and little kitchen supplies. You could find little kitchen supplies like this, really inexpensive, at the dollar store. So it tells you some things that you could decorate your home with, including making your home smell nice by simmering cinnamon sticks, cloves, and orange peel on the stove. You can make your own holiday incense. You can create your own holiday altar or shrine, which I plan on doing upstairs once I get all of my stuff situated for the winter season here. So you can make luminaries, which are like sand and paper bags, and anchor it with a lit votive candle. You could put the luminaries leading up the pathway up to your house, so it's very warm and welcoming for any visitors and company that you're having over the holiday season. It tells you how to make your own candles right here. And then there's something called ice candles, which I've never heard of. You suspend a candle wick over a clean wax carton or a candle mold, then fill completely with small ice cubes. And it kind of makes like a cool little pattern like this. And I think I've seen these in the stores before, but I never knew like how they were made like that. But now I know that it's from putting ice in there and letting it freeze like that. And then there's something called the Great Christmas Candle, which is lit throughout the season and particularly on Christmas Eve, associated with goodwill and fair fortune. The traditional candle is red, but any color may be used. As the candle is lit, repeat the following. And then it tells you the little incantation that you can say. So then there's just like a little craft for making an evergreen wreath. Then there's a Leaves of Gratitude solstice tree craft and a gift for the birds solstice tree craft, which is cute. So you can leave a little offering for little bird friends outside. Then there's another section for prayers and invocations. And now it's getting a little more spiritual. So there's structure for simple prayer, different invocations you could do to the old woman of winter, one you could do to Father Yule, one you could do to the life-giving sun on the solstice vigil. Then there's a meditation introduction on how to meditate around the solstice, a simple winter breathing meditation. And this is mostly outdoors, it seems like, but if you're not into meditating outdoors, you could definitely do this inside by the light of your Christmas tree or the warmth of your fire. Holy Winter Nights meditation. And this meditation is interesting. It's inspired by the works of Carl Jung. If anybody studies the tarot, you would know that he is the physicist that kind of came up with the themes of archetypes. And I always think he's really interesting to study. This is based on his works. And I want to read more about this because I actually haven't read too much of this part yet. And it just gives you a bunch of little keywords to focus on for your meditations. And this section of the book goes into winter retreat, which kind of encourages you to take some time on your own to just be with your own thoughts and your own energies and work with magical correspondences that resonate with you. Whether it's taking a long walk or just being by yourself, taking a hot shower, cleansing your energy, you can smudge. This is just basically about just taking some time for yourself to reflect. And winter is all about turning inward, and it's kind of like resonant of the hermit card in the tarot, taking the time to withdraw from society a little bit and withdraw from all the craziness and just be with your own thoughts a little bit and get to know yourself a little more. So that's kind of what the winter retreat section here seems like it's all about. I would definitely like to utilize this a little bit in this winter season, especially since this is my first year really acknowledging Yule as a Sabbat. I mean, I've always celebrated Christmas and I've always touched on certain Sabbats in the Wheel of the Year here and there, but I've never like consistently acknowledged or celebrated each Sabbat. I'm kind of trying to do that a lot more and getting more in touch with the changes of the seasons and each Sabbat and what each one holds. And each one is special in its own different way. And Yule is especially really special because my birthday is around this time and Christmas is around this time and it's all about family and it's just the spirit of the season. So here's a section called Rituals of Celebration. Basically, it talks about how pagans work rituals and whole festivities all the time and they take on a special focus whatever we consider the high holiday times of year. The winter solstice has always been a prime time for celebration and ritual, thanks to its themes of rebirth, new life, and solar return. So this chapter dives into some of those ideas and offers suggestions for solo, group, or family celebrations. And it talks about the word ritual, and it's about using music in ritual. It tells you kind of how to plan your rituals, gives you a little outline and questions you can ask yourself when planning. It tells you the importance of journaling and making notes about your own practices and your own magical workings, which is nice to revert back to, especially if you guys make your own Book of Shadows, which I've started, but I've not kept up with it as of lately. I really need to get back on that. I do have one video of my Book of Shadows. I really haven't worked on it since then, and I really need to get back into it because it's something that I really want to have to pass down for generations to come. Anyway, back to this, a fireside festivity ritual for any number of people. So basically it was saying what I was saying before. You can cook dinner over your fire, have holiday game night. It doesn't always have to be about magic. It's just about, you know, community and being with family and friends. Then there's a midwinter fire ritual for solitary practitioner. This coincides for me with the winter retreat kind of thing that I was talking about before. If you want to focus on your own personal magical workings and inner thoughts that you might want to reflect upon for the season. Basically tells you some settings that you can do this in, also the supplies that you might need, ritual preparations, and then the preparation for the actual ritual, and then it tells you some of the elements, how you can use them. This whole last chapter is basically about ritual work, and you may or may not want to use any of this because, like I said before, you infuse most of your magical workings with your own personal touch. It probably be more effective the more personal it is to you, because this, again, this is just one person's writings and take on the holiday. So feel free to just, like, you know, take whatever you want from here, but then put your own spin on it and make it your own. So this whole last section is about the ritual and spell work aspect of Yule. This last chapter is about the correspondences for Yule. So it just tells you your spiritual focus keywords, your magical focus and suggested workings, astrological timing, your archetypes, deities and heroes. And here's a funny one, Befana. Befana is actually an Italian witch. When we just went to Disney World, we were in Epcot, and we were in Italy in Epcot, and there was a little character play. This woman came out dressed as a strega, which in Italian means witch. She came out dressed as a strega, and her name was Befana, and she told this old folk story about the tale of Befana, the Italian witch. So I think it might be interesting to maybe pay tribute to Befana this Yule, because now I can, like, her story kind of resonates with me. So use whatever deity or whatever mother, goddess, god, hero, person in history, pay tribute to them maybe this Yule season. This is funny over here, magical beings. They have Krampus, which is a big one as of lately. Those movies came out. Some of the colors that you can use: green, gold, red, white are the main colors of the Yule season. Herbs and spices: cardamom, cinnamon, cloves, ivy, mistletoe, nutmeg, peppermint, rosemary, sage, saffron. And also remember that mistletoe, and maybe ivy too, I'm not sure, you cannot ingest those. Those are highly poisonous, so don't make any teas or anything, but you can use those in a charm, like a little bag charm to carry with you for good luck, prosperity, etc. All the other ones look like you can ingest. Tells you what trees you can use as correspondences. Evergreen, cedar, firs, pine, spruce, these are all big trees in the wintertime. Flowers are Christmas rose, poinsettias, crystals and stones. And this is interesting because aside from the turquoise, which is the December birthstone, I wasn't too sure like what stones were used around this time, but it says here that you can use onyx, which is the balance between physical and spiritual energy, which grounds and protects. Tanzanite dispels negativity, lifts depression, mental clarity, which, as I was talking about before, in the wintertime when there's not a lot of sunlight, your mood tends to drag a lot more. So tanzanite is definitely a good stone to harness for, to dispel all those negative and depressive thoughts during the wintertime. Turquoise, contentment, healing, power, and protection, that's my birthstone. And zircon, which is for calming and healing. Now, metals that you can use during this time are gold and lead. Animal totems are the bear, cow, oxen, reindeer, horses, pigs, ravens, reindeer, stags, and then here's some scents for oils. Tarot keys, the hermit, the magician, pentacles, and the world are all ones that are most used during this time of year, especially the hermit. Like I said before, the winter is all about introspective and going within and getting in tune with your own thoughts and getting to know yourself more. It's more about your inward persona, not so much about your outward persona to the world. So symbols and tools, it kind of tells you all the symbols and tools that you could use here. Popular foods around this time, activities and traditions of practice, acts of service, giving to the needy, feeding wildlife, furnishing warm clothing, for those who need it. Send packages to military, work in food banks and soup kitchens, all stuff that you can do to help your local communities. Holidays, traditions occurring during Yule and the New Year in the Northern Hemisphere. Then they have the ones for the Southern Hemisphere. And then here's some further reference books that you guys can read if you're more interested in any of these topics. And then they have bibliography for the author, because each of these Llewellyn Savitt Essential Series books are written by different authors. So this one is by Susan Moonrider Pesnecker, who is a college English teacher, nurse, and hearth pagan druid living in Northwest Oregon. She holds a master's degree in professional writing and loves to read, watch the stars, and camp with her wonderful poodle, and work in her biodynamic garden. She's founder of the Druid Grove of Two Coasts and the online Ars Vivarum Magicarum, a magical conservatory and community. You can visit themagicalconservatory.com. I'll put that in the description below. You can also visit her on SusanPesnecker.com and her Facebook author page, facebook.com/SusanMoonriderPesnecker. That is basically it, you guys. That is that book. I kind of did a thorough review, but there is a lot of information in here that I didn't read because it's just so much information. But like I said, if you are interested, this book was really relatively cheap. I think it might have been no more than $12 on Amazon. And I did the 2-day shipping, so I got it relatively quickly. You should definitely check it out. If you have any comments or questions, definitely let me know in the down bar down below. The next Savitt coming up is Imbolc, which is February 1st, so that will be the next Savitt book that I will be getting. I don't know if I'm going to do a video on that yet or not. I guess it kind of all depends on how the Savitt resonates with me. I would love to do a series on the whole spectrum of the wheel. It all comes down to time. But thank you so much, guys, for hanging out with me today. I hope to get out another couple videos before the winter solstice. Try the gingerbread poppet craft and also maybe do a potpourri or a blend video for you guys using some essential oils, which would be really fun to do as a giveaway, or a little idea for you guys to do at home as a gift for the holiday season to give away to your own loved ones. So let me know what you think in the comments down below. Any ideas you have, comments or questions, I'll be glad to answer them. My name is Justina, and you can visit me on my Instagram page at Bohemian Magic Studios. Join in on the discussion over there. I have lots of cute little stories, and you can also visit me on my own website at bohemianmagicstudios.com. I hope to see you guys very soon. Have a magical day and a wonderful Yule if I don't see you before then, but I hope that I do. Mwah. Bye.
If you liked this video, please be sure to give me a thumbs up, comment, rate, and subscribe. Also, be sure to watch my other magical videos and playlists by clicking the icons above. Have a cozy and merry Yule, everyone. Thank you so much for watching, and I hope to see you back real soon.